Please be seated. We'll hear argument in 22-27, Henry First Reserve Management. Justice Lehrman cannot be present this morning, but expects to participate in the decision. Justice Plan is not participating.
May it please the court. Mr. Heidler will present argument for relators. Relators have reserved 5 minutes for rebuttal.
May it please the court, limited liability of shareholders is a bedrock principle of Texas corporate law, but in this MDL proceeding arising out of explosions on TPC's premises, the courts have erroneously allowed the plaintiffs to proceed with their tort claims against TPC's alleged shareholders, the First Reserve private equity investors. This morning I would like to address three categories of allegations that the plaintiffs make against those investors. First, the plaintiffs allege that the investors are liable because they appointed members to the board that allegedly governed TPC's affairs, and the board in turn made decisions that caused the explosions. Second, the plaintiffs allege that the investors engaged in conduct that is consistent with industry standard practice in private equity. And third, the plaintiffs plead legal standards and legal conclusions, sometimes including the names of the parties here, but otherwise omitting the factual substance that is required to plead a cause of action under Texas law. So let me begin with these allegations about the board. The plaintiffs allege throughout their petition that First Reserve controlled TPC through the board of managers of Sawgrass Holdings, GP. The plaintiffs allege that First Reserve appointed two members to that board. And plaintiffs say that the board delayed and failed to approve maintenance, a turnaround that would have prevented these explosions.
But now, Holdings GP is a party in the trial court, a defendant in the trial court, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
But they're not one of the movements on this particular motion.
Yes, Your Honor. That's exactly right. And when a private equity firm like First Reserve invests in a portfolio company like TPC, it is customary for the firm to bargain for the right to appoint one or more members to the board that governs the portfolio company. This customary right enables the investor to monitor the portfolio company's operations and ensure that its investment is being well managed. Under established principles of Texas corporate law, a shareholder or an investor can exercise this customary right without making itself liable for the acts and omissions of the board.
Mr. Heidler, is there an allegation as to which specific First Reserve entity made this appointment, or does the petition just globally charge all of the entities?
It's global, Your Honor, and that's one of our complaints about the petition, is it doesn't tell us what we need to do and do an investigation and prepare a defense against these claims. It says all of these entities did all of these things without identifying which entity did which things so we can go prepare a defense. So it's not particular to any particular First Reserve entity. We analogize this situation to the one the court addressed in the Syntec case, where the court held that a company's power to appoint a majority of the members to the board of an HOA did not make that company liable for the board's acts and omissions in governing security at a condo complex. In Syntec, this court analogized the HOA to a corporation and recognize that an HOA is a separate legal entity from its unit holders, just as a corporation is a separate legal entity from its shareholders. In this case, of course, no analogy is needed because plaintiffs plead that the First Reserve investors are TPC shareholders, and the plaintiffs allege that the First Reserve investors are separate legal entities from TPC and its governing board.
Well, First Reserve only appointed two of the five board members, is that right?
Yes, Your Honor. Now, that's a distinction from Syntec. That's a distinction that helps us. Of course, in Syntec, the company...
the fifth board member. Was it the other four board members?
The fifth board member was a representative from TPC, TPC's executive leadership. You asked about the minority versus majority. In Syntec, the company had the power to appoint a majority of the members to the board. This court nevertheless held that the board's acts and omissions couldn't be imputed to Syntec. In this case, the plaintiffs allege that we had the power to appoint only a minority of board members, and plaintiffs don't plead any facts that, if true, would give the two board members that we could appoint the power to control board decisions. So for that additional reason, we don't think that the acts and omissions of the board can be attributed to First Reserve. Now, the Syntec case...
Would your argument be any different if it was every single board member?
It wouldn't, Your Honor, because under the Syntec case, that company had the power to appoint the majority of board members. Presumably, those board members then could exert control over the board. But this court drew a line, the corporate governance line, and said the board is a separate legal entity from the appointee shareholder. And so, even if you appointed the majority or even all the members of the board, their fiduciary duties at that point run to TPC. They don't run to the appointing company. That's what the United States Supreme Court explained in the Best Foods case.
Even though they were board members of GP, Sawgrass GP Holdings, you would say their duties did run to TPC.
Their duties run to TPC. That's a little bit of a strange flavor in this case. We don't think it matters to the outcome.
Which is why they're not a party to this motion.
Which is why they're not a party to the motion. That's exactly right.
Now, I was a little unclear. This First Reserve equity entities own all of FR Sawgrass LP.
I don't believe so, Your Honor. I think that there's different entities that own parts of that company. But the plaintiffs allege that all of these First Reserve entities collectively are shareholders of TPC. So in 91A, we've taken that allocation as true.
So the two Sawgrass companies that own Sawgrass Holdings were owned by people other than the equity people?
I believe they're all owned by the equity people, but there's different groups of equity people. That makes sense. Now, the Syntec case for this court is not an outlier. In the Gentry case and the Lucas case, this court recognized that related companies can have overlapping officers and directors without being liable for each other's torts. That's very similar to the explanation that the U.S. Supreme Court gave in the Best Foods case, where it said corporate officers and directors holding positions in related companies can and do change hats to represent each company separately. Now, these allegations that First Reserve controlled TPC through the board are incorporated into every one of the plaintiff's claims against First Reserve. But even accepting as true these allegations regarding the board's conduct, the fact remains that the First Reserve investors are separate legal entities and are not responsible for the board's acts and omissions. So any claim pleaded against the First Reserve investors that is predicated upon these allegations of conduct by the board has no basis in law under Rule 91A because it fails to invoke any exception to the default rule of limited liability for shareholders. Now, turning to the second category of allegations that the plaintiffs make, the plaintiffs contend that the investors engaged in conduct that is consistent with industry standard practice in private equity. But customary corporate conduct has never been enough to impose liability on a company's shareholders or parent companies. For direct liability, the United States Supreme Court in the Best Foods case explained that normal corporate conduct is perfectly acceptable for a parent company. The parent company can supervise a subsidiary company's budget. The parent company can provide policies and procedures for the subsidiary company to follow. The parent company can appoint members to the subsidiary company's board without becoming directly liable for accidents that occur on the premises of the subsidiary company. And for alter ego, this court laid out some similar rules in the SSP partner case and in the Lucas case, where this court explained that centralized control by a parent company and shared finances between parent and subsidiary companies will not make those companies liable for each other's torts. Here, the plaintiffs allege that First Reserve had financial interest, ownership, and control of TPC. SSP Partners and Best Foods, centralized control by a parent company is not enough to expose the parent company to direct or vicarious liability. The plaintiffs also allege that First Reserve gave TPC a business strategy. But this, too, is normal corporate conduct. This reflects centralized parental control in a family of companies. It is not a basis to impose liability on a parent company or a shareholder. Next, plaintiffs allege repeatedly that First Reserve exercised financial controls over TPC's expenses. But under the Coastal case from the Corpus Christi Court of Appeals and under the Best Foods case from the United States Supreme Court, a parent company can exercise financial controls over a subsidiary company's expenses without incurring direct liability. And again, under the SSP Partners case and the Lucas case from this court, the fact that two companies share finances is not enough to make them alter egos. All of these allegations describe standard corporate practices and don't provide any basis to impose liability on a shareholder or investor. Now, apart from these allegations of conduct by the board and allegations of customary corporate practices, plaintiffs plead paragraph after paragraph of legal standards and legal conclusions, but they don't plead the facts that would be required to plead a cause of action under those standards.
When we get to sort of the particulars of what the pleading says or doesn't say, should we be focused on the third amended petition or the fifth?
Third.
And why?
Because under Rule 91A5, when we filed the motion to dismiss, the plaintiffs have an opportunity to amend. They did that. We filed an amended motion. They didn't amend again, and so the petition that's considered for the Rule 91A motion is a third amended petition that was on file at the time of the hearing. Their deadline to amend for purposes of the motion, I believe, is 3 days before the hearing. And so once there's a hearing on that rule, on that petition, that's the petition that the court considers in determining whether the Rule 91A
motion. But I would guess that since that third petition has been, you know, in this proceeding, they would have amended to cure some of the, or at least attempt to cure some of the problems you're talking about. What is the sense of relying on the third?
So we rely on the third because that's what the rule says we rely on. They have not made any additional allegations that would change things. And in fact, you see in their merits brief before this court, they make brand new allegations about TPC's insurance coverage that really don't change anything. And so they're giving the court the allegations that they have, but they still don't have any factual allegations that would support a claim against the First Reserve investors. And remember, they've had significant discovery in this case. They've had thousands of pages of documents. They've had multiple corporate representative depositions. They know the facts. The problem for the plaintiffs is not lack of access to the facts. The problem is that the facts don't support any claim against the First Reserve investors.
So we're a notice pleading state, and we haven't adopted the federal standard of, you know, having to plead facts absent special exceptions. How does that affect a Rule 91A motion? I mean, obviously, if there aren't facts pleaded, you don't have to accept them as true. And so is that more what you're arguing, that because there aren't any facts pleaded that have to be accepted as true, there aren't enough facts that we have to accept as true that would establish the cause of action? Or are you saying that they had to plead more facts and it's somehow infirm for that reason?
So, but under Rule 91A, the no basis of law standard requires dismissal of the facts alleged in the petition and the inferences reasonably drawn from them, does not entitle the claimant to the relief sought. So that's the argument we're making.
It's really about what facts are there. You say there aren't the facts there that would need to be there in order to establish the legal basis for relief.
That's exactly right. And I don't think that's a departure from Texas law. If you look at the Kinder Morgan Sackroff case on fair notice pleading, that was not a 91A case, but it was on what is the fair notice pleading standard. This court explained it's not enough just to plead a legal theory. The plaintiff also has to plead the facts that would support the application of that theory. And then the Farmers and the Sanchez cases, which are on Rule 91A, the court said it looks to the facts pleaded in the petition to determine whether the claimant is entitled to any relief.
If we agree with you and agree that you're entitled to mandamus, is there any line that can be drawn that would prevent the result being that any time a trial court ever errs and denies a Rule 91A motion to dismiss, the party movement is entitled to mandamus relief? You know, when I started practicing law, I was told, you know, 99 out of 100 summary judgment motions are going to be denied because a good trial court judge knows he can never be reversed from denying summary judgment, only for granting it. Since then, we've got numerous interlocutory appeal avenues that the legislature has adopted, and now we've got the Rule 91A alternative to summary judgment, and it seems to me that all you're hanging your hat on here is, well, it's going to cost us a lot of money to have to try the case if this was wrong, but at least relatively speaking, that's true every time the denial of the Rule 91A motion to dismiss was wrong. How do we
standard is always whether the plaintiff has an adequate remedy by appeal. And deciding whether there's an appellate remedy, the Court of Appeals or this court is going to balance the benefits of mandamus review against the detriments. And here, one big benefit, if you're looking for something that makes this case different, one big benefit is the one pointed out in the amicus briefs that have been presented by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and the American Investment Council. Those organizations point out that this case in particular involves threshold issues of corporate law that are important not just to the parties here, but to the business community around the state of Texas and even around the country. And when you talk about cost and expense, that's a matter of degree. But as this court pointed out in the CSR case, in a mass tort action, mandamus review is more likely to be appropriate because even a meritless claim can impose such substantial strains on an defendant's resources. In this case, of course, arises out of an MDL proceeding that contains over 2,000 cases brought by more than 7,000 claimants. And so it doesn't serve anyone's interest to go forward with litigation and discovery if, in fact, these claims have no basis in law and should be dismissed.
Any other questions? Slide. If I could just follow up on what Justice Huddle was asking you about, your argument is that nothing in the live current, the Fifth Amendment petition, changes anything, but suppose that it did, and that you acknowledged that it didn't. The rule still says, because of the timing, would be required. But what would the effect of a decision be then? Is it just for the attorney's fees? What would really change between the parties if we were to rule on an old petition that says it was inconsistent with 91A's requirements, but the live one can go forward?
Oh, it's dismissal with prejudice.
Does it have to be?
Yes.
No question about that.
They have an opportunity to amend the petition prior to the hearing. They took that opportunity. They amended. They're standing on the petition that was on file at the time of the hearing.
So your contention is that the current live pleading is a nullity?
Correct. For purposes of the 91A motion.
Well, I'm talking about the litigation beyond that. I'm not talking about the 91A.
Well, if the court were to decide a name as a legal one, then the Fifth Amendment is the live.
No, I'm saying if it's correct that the third amended petition should have been dismissed, then the Fifth Amendment is wiped away, and that's valid only in case we deny mandamus. Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Hunter. We'll hear from the real party.
May it please support. Mr. Thompson will present argument for the real party in interest.
May it please the court. The question today, and really the only question, is whether or not the cause of actions pleaded by the real parties are supported by the actual allegations in the petition. The Rule 91A motion didn't challenge negligence or negligent misrepresentation, gross negligence, nuisance, or any of the claims that we presented in our petition. It challenged the alter ego aspect of the petition. Alter ego is not a cause of action. It is a theory of recovery. Rule 91A specifically says you can challenge a cause of action that has no basis in fact. It does not say you can challenge anything else. Also, we're at the pleading stage, and although the other side has said that we've had significant discovery, that's very misleading. We've had significant discovery with respect to jurisdiction. We had a contacts with Texas problem that we did a lot of discovery on. There's been zero merits discovery. So the fact that there's not a lot of allegations in the petitions about what these specific entities did and how they're arranged in the hierarchy of the business is not surprising because we really don't know. Because there's been nothing to let us know. There's been no discovery on that matter. So for that reason, and for the fact that
were you prohibited from that discovery?
Yes, sir. We were.
You were. So did the trial court limit the discovery to the personal jurisdiction issues?
Yes, they did, and they did not prevent discovery. The other reason is that these entities didn't just act like typical investment banking firms do when they came in and bought this company. Very different circumstances here. As we allege in the petition, these folks, SK and First Reserve, came in and bought this company and took it out of it. then they set up all these corporations in between who were relators and put distance between themselves and the facility itself. But the facility itself doesn't even have a board of directors. They rely on the board of directors of one of the other companies that's in the power group.
But it's not a party to this motion, as I understand.
It's not a party to this motion. It's a party to the lawsuit.
Right.
Isn't that a relatively sort of customary structure to have a GP be directing and in control of the LP?
Yes.
The asset, that seems normal.
Yeah, that part is normal. But these two companies put 80% of the directors on the board of directors. And they didn't just act like a board of directors. They were actually directing, as we set out in the petition, that they were controlling the day-to-day activities of the facility itself.
And that might be why they're not a party to this particular Rule 91A motion, right? They're not contesting, at least at this stage, that the board of the GP was exercising that level of control. That's really not the question for us either. We have to look at, was the board of the GP in turn being controlled, right, in order to be able to disregard the court reform?
Absolutely.
Can you identify a specific entity you think was controlling these two directors?
The relators. Oh, I'm sorry.
Which
of the four board members?
Well, no, which of the many entities, of the many First Reserve entities, that you contend controlled the two First Reserve directors that they appointed? Who appointed them to the GP board?
I'm going to say a First Reserve entity and an SK entity, the names of which are so closely related, I'm not going to be able to tell you the exact name of it, but I can follow up with it. They are part of this group that's been sued as defendants. And the petition, which is all we have to go on because we're still at the pleading stage. And, Your Honor, I will say that I don't think Rule 91A is intended as an alternative or some kind of adjunct to summary judgment because it's only relegated to that pleading that's been filed. So the relators are actually saying under no circumstances in Texas can investors in the company ever be responsible for the activity of a company they buy and hold in control? Well, I submit to this court that that's what's contrary to corporate law, not the fact that these folks have been sued. And if for some reason the plaintiffs are unable to prove that these companies control and actively conspire, as we think they did, to withhold funds for the necessary repairs at that facility that they knew were needed, then summary judgment's appropriate. It gets dismissed or we lose trial, whichever. And that's okay. That's what happens. But at this stage, to kick us out, we've had no discovery on what these companies do, other than the fact that we figured out that they actually control the day-to-day operations, would be wholly improper and unfair to plaintiffs altogether. In addition to taking control of the board and controlling the day-to-day management, they also made sure that the company...
I'm sorry, who controlled the day-to-day management?
The board.
Okay, but again, they're not a party.
They are not a party.
A party to this, yeah.
Right. But they're being controlled by relators.
And isn't that the piece of control that we have to focus on? The control by the relators over the GP board?
Yes, Your Honor, and that's what we don't know. We have alleged it, and we think it's right, and we don't think it's specious or if for some reason investment banking firms are concerned that every time they come to Texas they're going to get one of these motions, they have sanctions available to them, remedies available to them. But to say that they can never be sued in Texas is just not proper or proper under corporate law, even if Rule 91A was aimed at alter ego, and it's really not, and it should not be. And because of that, Rule 91A, the motion was improper to begin with.
So control is a legal concept.
loss was exerted. During our limited discovery, we were able to get from the corporate representatives and from the documents that were produced enough proof to say that we know that they controlled whether or not expenses were made, whether or not maintenance was conducted, whether or not the workers' comp claim was going to be litigated. I mean, these are not court-level decisions. Those are things that are day-to-day operations. That we think that they had their finger on the pulse of everything that was going on here. They made sure the plant was undercapitalized. They refused to let them have the improvements that they needed. And then there was a big explosion that blew up out of the city. There are thousands and thousands of individuals who were wrong, but also many, many Texas businesses that were damaged property-wise by this explosion. We're not talking about your run-of-the-mill plaintiff's case, I slipped and fell. We're talking about a mass disaster that was caused by the involvement of the relators. And for that reason, we think they should be, we think they should be held responsible, but certainly not allowed to get out of the lawsuit at this point.
One of your allegations throughout is that there was undercapitalization here. I'm wondering how you are judging that. I don't think that the petition says so, but what is your standard for saying they're undercapitalized? By what measure?
Your Honor, I am afraid that is not reflected in the record, and I honestly cannot answer that question. You're asking me all these questions, Judge, that I can't answer today. I wish you would stop. I apologize. I can't.
If it is true at this stage that it was undercapitalized because that's what's been alleged?
I think so. I don't think that that's a legal conclusion. It is a fact. So the fact that it was undercapitalized does have to be accepted as true. Whether or not it ultimately ends up being true, different story. So the other thing that I heard was that they're relying very heavily on the Syntec case, which is unique in that it was a board of directors of a condo. And also, it wasn't a 91A case. It was a summary judgment case. And in that case, the court concluded that there was no evidence of control necessary for liability to be imposed. It had nothing to do with allegations. It had nothing to do with the fact that persons higher up or board members can't ever be held responsible or those that control them. The other thing that was mentioned is, and this was by a judgment, was Federal Rule 12b-6, and whether or not we have the same standard, we really don't. And it's important for the court to know that because lots of lower courts have said that they're being guided by 12b-6 in their opinions. And that should be troubling because in Texas we have fair notice pleadings. That's Rule 47a. But the reason behind Twombly and Iqbal is the language of Rule 8a, and it's very specific language that they rely on, and it's the word show. And they held that because of that show language in the rule, there is a requirement that there be plausible, that there be facial plausibility to the claim. And that is that smacks of merits. There's a qualitative element of that determination that doesn't exist in our pleadings. Our pleadings are fair notice. If no person in the world can believe a fact, well, then that's a lack of basis in fact. But otherwise, it's not the same. It's not the same. And because of the differences in Rule 47A and Rule 8A, the same standard should not apply. Because otherwise, if you put that standard in place, you've read Rule 47A out of the civil procedural rules. You basically impose more on a plaintiff than fair notice. It's fair notice plus, and that's directly contrary to the civil rules. I think that is all, except for the fact that in addition to alleging control, we also, for alter ego, there has to be an element of harm or fraud. venture that was undercapitalized, and then blowing up half a city and violating many, many, many environmental laws, not only negligently but willfully, would be using a corporate structure to, in a wrongful way, that would work an injustice here, and that based on these pleadings, the court should deny the petition for writ of mandamus because this just isn't the case that's been presented to the court via the briefing. And based on the pleadings, which is about 70 pages long, it's not a list of legal conclusions listed over and over again. It's basically everything we knew. And one of the reasons we did that is because we knew it was coming, because we hadn't had any discovery, and we knew they were going to try to get rid of us.
Yeah, you mentioned the adequate appellate remedy issue. Do you agree that because this is an MDL with 7,000 plus claimants and complicated scenario, that this case is a little bit different, and if in fact the trial court was wrong to deny the 91A motion as to these specific defendants, it's better to go ahead and say that now?
I cannot.
It's better for you guys, so you're not wasting a bunch of time and money.
I will say that it's typically a sliding scale, you know, about whether or not it's so important and would cost so much money that it's worth it to go ahead and grant mandamus relief, is the way I think about it. And probably here, that would be a very difficult argument for me to make, to say that mandamus relief would be inappropriate. I think that
the only argument I've really heard is, well, except that we haven't really gotten enough discovery to be able to fix our pleadings according to discovery. But what counters that is, you filed suit 7 hours after the accident, so you kind of, you didn't do any of the public information discovery you could have done before filing the suit, so you kind of brought that upon yourself to some degree, it seems like.
No, Your Honor, we did do all that research, and it's reflected in our petition. You'll see. They absolutely did not when they filed the motion. We did file an amended pleading to try to meet any deficiencies that there may have been. And the third petition is not significantly different from the fifth petition with respect to plaintiffs. In fact, I can't think of anything that's different that would actually impact the result in this case.
What about the letter we got recently about the bankruptcy court? What's your position about that? Do you think that a bankruptcy court ruling would basically make it unnecessary for us to decide this case?
It might, but Your Honor, it's not presented to this court, it's not before the court, it's not relevant to the issues presented, and we really need a ruling about what 91A means. The court could hold it until the bankruptcy court rules, but that could be a long time, and if the court, the bankruptcy court, that is, rules in our favor, then the court still needs to decide the issue. The court should go ahead and do so. There's no reason to wait.
Is this case continuing, or is it effectively stayed by the bankruptcy?
It is continuing, Your Honor, so long as the bankruptcy court does not rule against us in that case. Unless the court has any questions, I'll see the remainder of my time.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Thompson. Mr. Heidler, you have 5 minutes.
So, Mr. Heidler, if you're assume that you're representing a plaintiff in one of these cases, and assume with me further that if there were adequate discovery, the facts would show that all the Castleberry factors were met, but there hasn't been discovery. What is a plaintiff supposed to do to plead? I mean, they have to have a factual basis to plead facts in their petition in good faith. So would you say that even in cases where all the Castleberry factors are met, that's impossible to do?
Not at all, Your Honor. So the rules deal with that situation. We have Rule 202 that allows a plaintiff to get pre-suit discovery as part of an investigation to learn whether the facts would support alleging a cause of action. And you refer to Castleberry. In the alter ego context, what's happening is there's a claim against a company like TPC, and the question is, do I also have facts to state a claim against the shareholders or the investors or someone like that? In that situation, a plaintiff can do what the plaintiffs did here. They can sue the company They can do discovery. He says the discovery has just been jurisdictional. I'm informed by lead trial counsel that's not true, that they have had merits discovery from TPC, particularly going to the relationship between TPC and First Reserve. They have 2 years within the statute of limitations to do that discovery, learn the facts.
Could you do that if they're disputing jurisdiction? Could you file Rule 202?
I don't know whether there would be a personal jurisdiction bar, but you could get...
So wait, you can get discovery under Rule 202 from somebody you don't have jurisdiction under.
I was going to say, there may be a personal jurisdiction, may be a bar for the entities that have a personal jurisdiction objection, right? But they could certainly get discovery from TPC. TPC is a Texas company. And if the First Reserve investors have been at TPC flipping the switches and doing all the things that, you know, that they contend, then that those facts would be available from TPC. They've had multiple corporate representative depositions from TPC. They've had, you know, thousands of pages of documents. If First Reserve had its hands on this facility, they would know about it. And that's how discovery is intended to work. Justice Huddle, you asked about the bankruptcy proceeding. If the bankruptcy court rules that some or all of these claims have been released, at most that would give us a good defense that we could assert in the trial court. But right now, these claims against First Reserve remain pending in the trial court. And until the plaintiffs non-suit them with prejudice or until a court dismisses them, those claims remain valid. And if we have a defense that we think the claims have been released in a bankruptcy court, that might be something we could assert in summary judgment, but it wouldn't be grounds to deny a Rule 91A motion.
Is it your position that the third amended petition does not allege that the relators controlled decisions that caused the explosion?
Yes, our position, if you look at paragraph 14, if you look at paragraph 51, paragraph 123, they explain it in decent detail, the corporate governance structure of TPC. So the relators appointed two of the five members to the board of Sawgrass Holdings GP, and they say very specifically in paragraph 14 that it was the Sawgrass Holdings GP board that controlled TPC. So they're not, we don't read their petition to allege that the relators directly controlled TPC at all.
No, but that they result, that they effectively controlled the decisions made by the GP board, that the decisions that were relevant to the causation of the...
I don't think they even allege that.
If they did, you would have no Rule 91A motion. If they alleged that, if they adequately alleged that under the fair notice standard, then you wouldn't have a right to dismiss it.
Well, they would have to allege a couple of things, right? If that kind of a legal theory would work, they have to allege that these board members basically breached their fiduciary duties, right? Because their fiduciary duties run to TPC. They don't run to First Reserve just because First Reserve appointed them to the board. And then they would have to plead facts to show that the decisions by these board members when they're acting on the board made a difference in the case. And by intentional design, they can't do that because we had the power to appoint only a minority of the directors. And so even then, I think we'd have a Rule 91A motion. It would be a different motion, but I think we'd still have the motion. He brought up the nuisance claim, the gross negligence claim. All of plaintiff's claims arise out of these same factual allegations of control. So you take the nuisance claim, for example. It's five paragraphs long. Most of that is just reciting legal standards from cross-text, explaining what a private nuisance injury is in Texas. When it comes time to plead the facts to support a nuisance claim, they rely on the, quote, above-mentioned acts and omissions, which are the acts of control of the board, which is an invalid legal theory, and allegations that we've committed, you know, customary corporate conduct, like supervising a subsidiary company's budget. So we are seeking dismissal of all the claims. If I could just conclude, the plaintiffs have had years to research this case and determine whether there are any facts that would support a claim against First Reserve. And yet at this late date, all we have is pleadings of legal standards and allegations made against other companies like the GP or TPC or TPC's contractors. As the United States Chamber of Commerce and the American Investment Council have explained in the briefs in this situation, Texas law should not permit a plaintiff to proceed with claims against a company's shareholders, as we ask the court to grant a petition.
Any other questions?